Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And it is a delight to be with you today and to be able to share with you in a few moments a message from the Word of God. I wanted to say thanks, David, for those kind words that you gave for both myself and Betty. And thank you so much, and for the very warm welcome that we've received. We've had opportunity already to have some hospitality at David and Barry's house, and it's been wonderful. And I wanted to thank you as a church for all of your support over the 35 years. That's quite the accomplishment, 35 years. Think about that for a moment. It does tell us a little bit about you. Some of you may feel like you're a little older. That goes with the territory after 35 years, if you've been here from the beginning. But thank you for making it possible to be in fellowship with us for that many years, for all your support, all your prayers, and especially the prayers that you were offering up for me too while I was going through some surgery back in November. Sure appreciate that as well. And I also want to thank you for making it possible for my wife Betty to be able to be with us for this occasion, because she doesn't get that chance to travel with me all that often, and this has been a real treat to have her here and to be able to enjoy this visit with you. Well, anniversaries are wonderful things, and indeed, when you stop and think about it, they are wonderful because of some things. One, there are memories to anniversaries, right? That just goes with it. We think back over 35 years, and we think about how wonderful God has been to you and as a congregation. And there are things, of course, in 35 years that you are probably happy to remember. And sometimes, over 35 years, there might be the occasional thing, you wish you could forget, right? That's what life's like. We can't erase the past, but it is important to remember God's faithfulness over 35 years. One day this gentleman was sitting, he was reading his paper, and his wife came up to him and she said to him, look, she said, I wanted to ask this question. Do you know what day it is? As she whispered in his ear. And he said, of course I know what day it is. And then he got thinking afterwards, after she left, I have no idea what today is. But he began to panic, thinking it could be, maybe it's her birthday. And so he thought to himself, well, I better do something about that, because she's very sensitive about these kinds of occasions and I don't dare want to forget. And so she left, and he was thinking, his mind was spinning. And as he went to work, he thought, okay, maybe what I'll do is, he said, I will go and down to the florist and I will order up some roses and I'll have them sent specifically right to home and make sure that she receives them. But then, as the day was wearing on, he began worrying that flowers may not be so much of a thing to really celebrate for such an important day, whatever that day was. And he said, well, what if it's our anniversary? And he started to think some more. So he went to the jewelry store down from his office, and he picked out a real nice necklace. And he had that specially delivered for his wife. Well, as he started home from work, his mind was still spinning. He decided that maybe what he should do is also stop by and pick up a real expensive box of chocolates, just in case. Well, as he pulled into the driveway, his wife ran out to greet him. She was quite animated, quite excited, really quite happy, in fact. And he thought, great, this is just incredible. So he gets out of the car, and then he passes her the chocolates. And she's even more ecstatic over the fact that he brought her some chocolates. And she said, oh, honey, she said, I can't get over this. This is the best Groundhog Day I've ever had. It's not likely he's going to forget Groundhog Day again when it comes around. Not likely. And it could be that his wife might even want to remind him about it again. I'm sure she will. Well, memories are wonderful. And today you're celebrating 35 years of God's faithfulness as you, as a church, think about all that God has done for you. Nostalgia, though, can be one of those things in life that's a happy time and a melancholy time, too. If you think about it, there are some things you'll cherish about the past with fondness, but you will also live in the present. You have to live in the present because you obviously cannot go back there. You cannot relive life. So while others, you see, when I'm talking about happy and melancholy, this is what I want to say. Some of you might cherish the past with fondness, but you will live in the present. While others will live in the present, but you'll be stuck in the past. It's never good to be stuck in the past. There seems to be a spiritual law about life that applies to all of us that are here this morning, and to all of us that are at this church, specifically this morning. Memories can help us cherish the past, and they can remind us again about all that God has done for us. But did you know that forgetting our past is an important spiritual discipline as well? That's the title of my message this morning, and if Nathan has it, he can bring it up. And I wanted to let you look at the title for a moment. The older we get, the more forgetful we must become. Now, that's not hard for some of us, right? The older you get, you say, Pastor, I don't need to work on this one. I got this one down real well. But spiritually, you do. Spiritually, we all have to work at this, because as we get older spiritually, it's important for us to learn this law about life, and that is forgetting our past is a very important thing. Now, you might say, well, you know, that's kind of raining on my parade today, so to speak. We're here to celebrate 35 years, and we are indeed, and let's never stop celebrating all that God has done. But we cannot be fixated there. And for example, I'm going to share with you a verse of scripture that I want you to look at. And now this is God, okay, speaking through the prophet Isaiah. And it's really important that we understand the context here, because he's reciting Israel's history. And it's quite a stellar history. In fact, where he starts off with this is this in verse 16. And this is what he says. Look at what the text says. But I am the Lord, and I opened a way through the waters, making a dry path through the sea. I called forth the mighty army of Egypt with all of its chariots and horses. I drew them beneath the waves, and they drowned their lives, snuffed out like a smoldering candle wick. Now, at this point, had the prophet stopped and had he just fixated on this, all Israel could have said, indeed, that's so true. We've heard about it from generation to generation, about your mighty miracle that you gave us that day. But he didn't stop there. He didn't allow Israel to think that this was all that you should think about when it comes to me and my dealings with you. And so he goes on, the prophet says this, but forget all of that. Now stop and think a minute about what God is saying to Israel. To forget all of that. What? The entire exodus from Egypt. The entire drowning of all the Egyptian army. Forget it. Don't remember that anymore. Now you might say, well, that's astounding that God would tell them to forget such a wonderful miracle, but it's in context. God is saying to them, the reason for this is obvious. And he goes on to say, it's nothing compared to what I'm going to do for you. Nothing. It's like, when you stop and read that, you sort of think, then what are we to expect? What new thing are you going to do? And he goes on to tell them, he says, for I'm about to do something new. See, I've already begun. Do you not see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I'll break rivers in a dry wasteland. The wild animals in the fields will thank me, the jackals and the owls too, for giving them water in the desert. Yes, I will make the rivers in the dry wasteland so my chosen people can be refreshed. The obvious answer to this question, why would God tell them to forget such a memorable occasion, is obvious when we read this. And that is, he didn't want them to get hung up there about their past, because he was going to do, listen carefully, even greater things for them. So there's a reason about life as to why we need to think about the present and the future and not just the past. While the past can be wonderful, and indeed it is, 35 years is nothing to snuff about. It's an exciting thing to think that your church has been in existence for 35 years here in this community. God has indeed been faithful to you, as he was to Israel when he took them through on dry land and destroyed all of Pharaoh's army. Indeed, he was faithful to them too. But then he says to them, but forget that. And I'd like to tell you today, without doing you any disservice, and certainly not to be very nonchalant about this, but I'd like to say to you today, forget those 35 years, because God has something better for you in store even yet than those 35 years. Now, it takes a little faith to believe that, because maybe some of you are looking back and thinking, well, you know, it's been pretty exciting these last 35 years. But God is not now sleeping. He has not led Israel, of course, through the wilderness, only to sleep and leave them to themselves. No, God is devising a plan in the future for them, and God is saying, I'm going to be doing something wonderful, something new and exciting. How many of you know God is not static? God is not dead. God is every much alive today as he was 35 years ago when he called you out like he called Egypt. But I believe he's telling you today, now forget that. Now, I don't know if some of you realize how important it is to be forgetful as you get older spiritually, but it is critically important. And no one in the scripture captures the essence of this spiritual forgetfulness better than the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul teaches us in Philippians chapter 3 something very profound and very important about the Christian life. And how many of you know that the Christian life is important individually as much as it is collectively? You are a part of the body of Christ, but you live a Christian life within that body. And so how you respond also affects the entire body of believers here in the church. And Paul is one that really highlights this principle of getting older and learning how to forget his past. Let's look at it for a moment, and we're going to pick it up in Philippians chapter 3. And I want you to notice what he starts out with. He starts out with remembering all kinds of things. And so he says, I was circumcised 8 days after my birth. Then he says, he says, of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin. I'm a Hebrew, and my parents were Hebrews. I had a strict view, he says, of the law, which is why I became a Pharisee. I was so enthusiastic, I tried to hurt the church. And no one could find fault. No one could find fault in any way, he said, about how I obeyed the law of Moses. Without a question, Paul's life as a Jew was impressive. His resume was stellar. There was nothing you could find at fault with Paul in his life in terms of his past. He was a very successful individual from all counts, looking at him through a Pharisaical lens, through a Jewish lens. Everything Paul had in his past was a wonderful thing in terms of a resume. But then Paul makes some very startling statements. He follows up after all of this is said and done. He follows up in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 7 with this. Remember, he starts remembering the past, and then he moves and transitions into forgetting it. Watch closely what he does. So he says, those things were, notice the operative word here is were, it's past tense. Those things were important to me, but now I think they are worth nothing because of Christ. Not only those things, he says, but I think that all things, he said, are worth nothing compared with the greatness of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. Because of him, he said, I've lost all of those things, and now I know they are worthless trash. I consider everything, he said, a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. And he ends up by saying, I consider them rubbish that I may gain Christ. Paul was willing to jettison this cargo of success, This ability to say, I was all of this. I was a wonderful Jew. Nobody could find fault with me in any way how I obeyed the law of Moses. I was a perfect Jew. But then he goes on to say, it's meaningless. It's just something in my past that I can abandon. I can jettison this cargo and I can throw it overboard. I do not need to hold on to this. This is not something that's important to me today. Too many times in the Christian life, we can often get to a place or a plateau in our journey as a Christian and even as a church, where we get to a place where we think we've arrived and we've somehow can just settle down into this chronic state of inertia. It's not what God wants for us. Not at all. God wants us to keep moving, keep daring to believe him, keep being excited about a future that's in front of us. He does not want us to get hung up anywhere on some plateau in life, as either in an individual sense or in a collective sense as the body of Christ. He wants us to move on. And Paul was trying to say, if I wanted to, and he could have gone around and boasted about the kind of resume he had. He could have went around and always brought that up to people, saying to them, listen, this is who I am. I'm not just Paul the apostle, but I am Paul, the wonderful Jew, the wonderful Pharisee, and just listed all the wonderful things about himself. But he didn't. He said, it's all just useless. Trash, he called it. And he was willing to let it go. He was willing to put it into the past and leave it there. Now, it is quite an amazing statement when you think about it, that he wants to live his life in such a way now that he may gain Christ, that he may actually focus all his energy, all his life now, not on being a good Jew, but being a good follower of Jesus. So how is he doing at that? How are you doing at that? Have you made that decision today to say, I'm going to follow Jesus? And I have decided that several years ago. So the question I want to ask you this morning is, how is that going for you? Paul lets us in on a secret about his life. And it's very important that we see it, because it helps us to understand why he could come to the place in his life where he could look at the past and put it into perspective and now look at the present and also see that for what it was and could be. So Paul says in chapter 3, verse 12, notice what he says. Not, he says, that I've attained all of this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but, he says, one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Now, let's just take a little bit of a sense of Paul's history. It's 25 years now, at this point when he's writing to the Philippian believers, that he's been in ministry. 25 years. Now, he's in a prison. It's a dark, damp Roman prison. And he's writing this letter to the Philippians, a letter, by the way, if any of you know, it's a letter of joy. It's often referred to as one of those epistles of joy. Now, you would probably ask yourself the question, I would, and you would be right to do so too, that during this time since his conversion, and during these 25 years, the Apostle Paul, if you know anything about his life at all, you know that it was not an easy journey serving Jesus. Paul had his heartaches and his heartbreaks, and he had a lot of things that he had to go through in 25 years. And now on top of this, okay, he finds himself in prison for preaching the gospel. Now, what happens in prison often to some people is that they begin to second-guess themselves. They look at what got them there. They start to say, you know what, if I would have toned it down a little bit, if I would have been less bold, if I would have just not done what I did, I may not be here today. And they begin to let this go on in their minds, and they begin to say, you know what, if I get out of here, if I do, I'm going to make a commitment to just pipe down a little bit and go about my business and not stir up any trouble, cause any problems, no matter what comes my way. I mean, you might think prison was working on his mind, and it does do that to some people, but we don't see any indication of that. Nothing of that sort of indication is in the life of Paul at all. Now, why is that? Well, after 25 years and now in prison, Paul has some advice for the Philippians, but he also has some advice for every one of us. And so first of all, let me just share with you three things in this text that Paul is bringing to our attention and to our importance, okay? The first thing is, we need to assess our present situation. In verse 13, the first part of that verse, Paul says, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. Now, what is Paul really saying here? Now, if anybody had the right, you would think, to say, I have achieved or I've accomplished some great things, well, you would think it would be Paul. I mean, can any of us hold a candle to him? When you stop and think about all the wonderful things that he was able to accomplish, Paul says, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of the prize for which Christ called him. In other words, what Paul was saying was, in the modern vernacular, he had not arrived yet. Now, to me, that's an amazing statement. Paul hasn't arrived yet. And yet, he wrote most of the New Testament. He helped spread Christianity throughout the entire Roman Empire. He confronted the critics and the cults of his day, and he made an incredible impact on the world of his day. And yet Paul says, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. So let me ask you the question today. What do you think he means when he says the word consider? For I consider myself not to have taken hold of it. The word consider is an interesting word, and it means to assess, it means to reflect, it means to contemplate or ponder over something. And here is Paul pondering over his walk with Christ. He is taking a good, hard look at his life there in prison. And he says, I don't have it all together. I haven't arrived. I'm not perfect. I have much to accomplish yet. Now, I think that's incredible because that gives me hope. I don't know about you this morning, but that gives me incredible hope to think that if Paul hadn't arrived yet and he didn't consider his life to be a place where he could say, I have made it, then I think there's hope for you and me today to also pipe in with Paul and say, guess what? As we assess our lives this morning, we could also say, I consider my life yet not to have taken hold of that for which Christ has called me forward to a plain as well. And the reason is because we're still on this journey. We have not arrived yet. We can't claim that spot and say we've made it. So the word consider is an interesting word, and prison had not soured Paul. He had no regrets. He was sitting there and he was thinking, he was contemplating, he was considering his life. And as he was writing to them, he was saying to them, I've not arrived yet. And I think he was trying to tell the Philippians, neither have you. But there is hope for you, because what you need to do, he said, is you need to learn to put the past in perspective, and you need to press on. And the older you get in your journey with Jesus, the more you must become forgetful. Paul wasn't sitting there pining after the good old days, and he did have some, by the way. All the things that Paul went through were not all bad. There were some exciting things in Paul's life. There were some exciting things about ministry, and he had some. And often you will hear him talk about the first convert that came to know Christ, or he will talk about someone else affectionately who also is growing in their faith in the Lord. There were many things that Paul highlighted that were quite exciting, but he didn't sit there in that prison and pine after all of the good old days. You know, the good old days. Can I say something about those? You know what about the good old days? People in churches that I've pastored in the past, they pined after the good old days. Now, I never really quite knew as a pastor what in the world they were talking about, because I wasn't there, but to them, they thought those good old days were really quite something. They talked about them often, and they kept thinking that the past in some way or other was always better than the current present situation they were in. And there are times that, you know, it used to annoy me as a young pastor to hear them talk about those good old days. I wondered today, I never really could figure them out, I could never really understand them, and I wondered why these people always wanted to go back to the good old days. I would think and often would say in messages to them, do you remember the good old days when you had Ringer washers? Now, for those of you that are a little younger, you don't have a clue what I'm talking about, right? That's fine. Some of you older people, though, you know what a Ringer washer is. And my mom, she used to say to me, don't stick your fingers anywhere close to those rollers. Yeah, that's back in the good old days. And now we got washers with buttons everywhere, cycles galore, right? Yeah. So we don't want to go back there, maybe, but some talk about those good old days. Remember back in the good old days? Maybe they didn't do that out here in this climate, but back in my climate where I grew up, my mother used to hang my clothes out on the clothesline in the winter, and she'd bring them back stiff as boards into the house because there was no dryer back then, and dry them in the house. Remember back in the good old days when we had typewriters? No. Some of you were saying, typewriters? Yeah, you remember back then when we couldn't copy and paste and delete and undo? I just got to rip the sheet out and start all over again. Whiteout just didn't cut it, especially if you're trying to put across a really good presentation. Yeah, all those good old days. And then do you remember when you had a cold day outside, you had to go out, and you had to actually physically wipe the snow off your windshield, open the door, start your car, and warm it up? That was back in the good old days. And now you just go out, point your little remote at your car, and warm it up. Right? Maybe not so much here, right? But you get what I'm saying. People don't realize that we have many modern things today. And I know in their homes, these people I used to pastor would never want to go back to those good old days. Not those things that I mentioned or framed, but somehow nostalgia is a crazy thing, isn't it? It makes us think that back there was such a wonderful time. They seem to envision some kind of golden, idyllic existence in the past. No energy crisis, clean air, clean rivers, streams, close families, good jobs, you know, the simple life, the good old days. Well, here's an excerpt from a national periodical which reflects about just how bad things really are. And of course, you might, after hearing this, say, that's our world. And it starts off by saying in the periodical, it says, the world is too big for us. Too much is going on, too many crimes, too much violence and excitement. And try as you will, you get behind in the race in spite of yourself. It's an incessant strain to keep pace, and still you lose ground. The article goes on to say, science is emptying its discoveries on us so fast that you stagger beneath them. And it just seems like you're always left in a state of hopeless bewilderment. The political world's news seems to change so rapidly, you're out of breath, trying to keep up pace with who's in and who's out. Everything is high pressure. Human nature just can't seem to endure much more of this. Now that sounds like something from one of today's modern newspapers, right? Yeah. Well, you'd be wrong. It appeared over 185 years ago, on June the 16th, 1833, in what was called the Atlantic Journal. You know, back in those good old days. We must always be able to frame the past in its proper context. And we must always be able to see where we are in relation to our past, because we don't live there. We live literally in our present. So don't pine away for anything over the past 35 years that you have seen God do and God has been so faithful to you about. Don't pine away after that. Begin to dream, begin to focus about what it is that God could have you do in the next 35 years. Begin to think that way in your mind. When Paul said, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, that was not a statement of defeat. Nowhere do we feel that Paul is saying, I'm omitting something here in that I have not accomplished this. Paul didn't see it as a defeat. Paul saw it as a statement of longing, a statement of ambition, a statement of desire, a statement of hope. Paul was looking and longing for something more. I don't consider myself to have yet attained it, but, and here's that wonderful word I love, that word, but. Because you see, the next thing that Paul does is he tells us that, okay, we need to move on. And so as we assess our present situation, we need to look honestly at ourselves, both collectively and individually. We need to say, where am I in my journey? Where am I in my relationship with Christ? And then where are we as a church in relation to following Christ and serving him in this community? Next thing Paul is telling us to do is to eliminate the past that holds you back. And so he says, one thing I do, he says, I forget what is behind. And that is something we have a tribe, I want to say we have a lot of trouble with that, for the most part. It's being able to say, okay, I'm going to forget it, I'm going to move on. But Paul said, one thing I do, he said, I forget these things that are behind. So what is it that we have to forget? Well, there are many things in life that we could say we have to forget. But first of all, we need to forget all the failures of our past. Now, I'm sure there's not one of you here that hasn't blown it at some point over something. I'm sure there's not one of you here that doesn't have something that you look back at your past and say, you know what, I wish really I hadn't done that. Or I wish that didn't go the way it did. And I wish I would have made a different choice, different decision. All of us could do that. I don't think there's any of us here that are an exception to that. All churches, all individuals have things in the past that they wish they could forget. So what might it be this morning that might be holding you back in relation to some of these failures in your past? Paul chose to forget the failures of his past. And you might say, yeah, though he was the Apostle Paul, it might have been quite easy for him to do. But let me stop you for a moment to think about Paul for a second. What was it that Paul had to forget? Well, it's quite the list, by the way. Paul persecuted the church. Paul put people literally in prison because they were followers of the way, followers of Jesus. He orchestrated the stoning of others and their death, including Stephen, the first church martyr. How that must have haunted Paul. How that must have sat on him and made him think, you know, look at what I did. Now I'm an apostle for the church, but look at my past. I persecuted the church. I imprisoned people. I had them killed for their faith. So when you think about your past, when you think about your failures and how bad they might be, put that into context here with the Apostle Paul, who's telling you, but this one thing I do, I forget those things which are behind or in the past. You can do it too. It's a conscious decision that you must make if you're going to have any spiritual progress in your journey with Jesus. Paul didn't sit around letting those things cripple his progress, though. And we can't sit around either, beating ourselves up about everything that we've done and everything we've blown in the past. There are things in your past, I know, you're not proud of them, and you, if you had the opportunity, would love to do them over again, but that will not be afforded to you. You will not have that ability to change the past. Whatever failures you've had back then, in the past, whatever memories that still haunt you, whatever you should have done or wish you had statements that you can come up with, well, you can think about all of those, but they're not going to help you because in Christ, we need to learn to put those in their proper context. And that is, they are in the past. And you need to move on and live in your present. Whatever sins God has forgiven you of, don't let the devil bring those up and constantly remind you of that. Many Christians are impeded in their progress to serve Christ because they're still living in the past, dwelling on things that they once did that the Savior has forgiven them of. Don't go there. Jesus doesn't go there. So why are you going there? Learn to accept the reality of his forgiveness. Learn to accept that he wants you to live now and in his forgiveness, in the present, and move on in your life. Whatever you do, there's things in your life you've got to put them behind. No matter what they are, God can help you do that. Then the second thing we need to do that Paul is reminding us of is that we need to forget our successes. Now, you might think, well, that's easier? Not at all. For many of us, our successes might be those very things that hang us up. Because we look at those things, those accomplishments we've made in life, and we begin to get arrogant and proud about our achievements. And many times we begin to think that, you know, we don't tell anybody this because we know it's not a spiritual thing to do. But we often will walk around with an air of arrogance, knowing that I'm special. God's really got a trophy in me. Now, I won't tell you that, but I'm going to act like that. It's going to be errors that I just brood all over me. You'll see it. It comes off me so easily. But see, because you think somehow that you're successful, you hear what Paul said? Look, I had a stellar resume. It's rubbish. Listen to this, church. No matter what I could look back in my past and pull up and say, look at what I was. No, Paul said, it's garbage. I threw it overboard that I may gain Christ and him only. I don't want to gain any recognition. I don't want to gain any accolades. What I want more in life than anything is to pursue Jesus. I want him and him only. So we need to forget the successes because they can make us complacent. Successes can tempt us to coast along on our laurels. Well, they can make us feel very proud, and nothing can create a state of chronic inertia greater than the soul's ability to begin to focus on their successes. When this happens, you'll stop growing, you'll stop learning, you'll stop reaching out and trying to grow in your faith, you'll end up ending in a state of mediocrity, and this will become your station and your lot in life. You will bask in these successes, but you will fail to grow in your knowledge and relationship with Jesus, because what Jesus wants you to do is he wants you to jettison that cargo, all those successes, and throw them overboard so that you might gain him and know him only. Don't become intoxicated as a Christian with all the things you think you've accomplished for him. They are just that. They are things by his grace and his goodness that he's allowed you to accomplish, but they are not the primary thing. Primary thing is him and him alone. In the 4th century, a young Greek artist by the name of Timanthus, he studied under a very respected tutor, and after several years, the teacher's efforts seemed to have finally paid off when Timanthus painted a very exquisite work of art. Unfortunately, though, Timanthus became so enraptured with his painting that he would come in day after day, sit in his chair, and he would become just enraptured with his work of art. As he gazed at this work of art, it was easy for his tutor to see that he was becoming quite absorbed with his success. So one day, Timanthus comes into the studio only to discover that his entire painting had been blotted out with paint. Now, angry and very upset, he ran to his tutor, and he said to his teacher, "Who did this?" demanding to know an answer. Well, his teacher admitted to him, looked him straight in the eye, and he said, "It was me that destroyed your painting." "Why did you do that? What were you thinking?" Timanthus says, "I did it for your own good. That painting was hindering your progress. So," he said, "I want you to start again and see if you can do even better." Well, Timanthus had to think about that because at last he thought he had painted something that was a perfect and exquisite work of art. But fortunately for Timanthus and for us, he took his tutor's advice and he began to go back to the canvas and he began to paint. And we are told that after taking that advice under heart and not looking back at his successes and being focused there, he went on to paint another exquisite work of art called The Sacrifice of Iphigenia, which is regarded as one of the finest paintings in all of antiquity. Of course, we have to ask the question, well, what would have happened if Timanthus just, in his anger, said, I'm not going to bother, I did my best, I'm not going to try to do better, and just walked off and forgot all about it. But he didn't. He took his tutor's advice and painted another picture. Today, Bay Community Church, let's celebrate all of your church's past successes. But remember, you cannot remain here intoxicated with your successes. You cannot stare at the quote-unquote paintings that you've created over 35 years. You must paint a new picture of your future. You must create a new and a stunning work of art, and you can, by God's grace. The best is yet to come for each of you and for this church if you live your life today in the light of eternity. Number three, Paul tells us that we need to press on. So first, let's assess our present situation and be real about ourselves. Let's not look at ourselves and think we're something we're not. Let us consider where we truly are in our relationship with Jesus. And then secondly, let's learn to forget the past, both our failures and our successes. And thirdly, Paul says, but I strain towards what is ahead. In other words, Paul says, I am pressing onward. I'm not stopping here. I'm not sitting here lamenting the fact that I'm in a Roman prison. I'm not getting sour. I'm not getting bitter, which a lot of times we can do. And you know how easy that is to do, to get bitter, to get sour as a Christian. It can happen to any of us. That's why the apostle who wrote the book of Hebrews said, beware. It's a danger, see? Beware lest this root of bitterness spring up within you and poison and defile your whole entire being. Paul didn't do that. Paul pressed on. He was looking ahead. He was looking at a better life. And he was saying, if I get out of this prison, well, I'm not reconsidering things. I'm not piping it down. As a matter of fact, Paul would, a little bit later, in this same chapter, he would say to them that I plan on getting out. And when I do, he says, I want you to pray for me that I will preach the word of God even more boldly than I have in the past. Wow. Not piping down one bit. Paul said, we can do it. Press on means to run swiftly. And before Paul was a follower of Christ, Paul would often persecute the church, chasing after them surely with all of his might. Now Paul is chasing after Christ. Same intensity, but the direction and the focus was entirely different. Straining towards what is ahead is a word that implies to me that Paul was using all of his energy in an effort to obtain the prize which Christ Jesus had called him toward and to achieve. Imagine a church today filled with people like this, where that is their life pursuit. Not looking backwards, but looking ahead to the prize which is in Christ Jesus. A church that asks God how they can best live their lives in this present moment to achieve all that he wants them to achieve in this community. You know, the church isn't where you meet today. You might think it is, it's not. The church isn't a building, it never has been. The church has always been a people. It is always who you are and always what you do. The church is a human outworking of the person of Jesus Christ in each of us as Christians. Let us not go to church ever on a Sunday. Let us remember we are the church. Let us remember our past for 35 years and be thankful for his faithfulness, yes, no question. But let us also be the church that dares to believe for a future of yet another wonderful 35 years of dreaming all that God can accomplish through us as his church. Now, as you look towards the future, will there be headwinds? Of course there will. I would not paint a picture of saying to you as a church that the next 35 years are not going to be without some headwinds. But remember this, it's an old sailor's thing, don't forget it. You cannot change the direction of the wind, but you can adjust your sails to accommodate and reach your destination. Keeping a healthy perspective, church, is important. And we must remember that in our pursuit of being the best we can for the Lord. Perspective is critical. A man one day, he walked up to a little league baseball game and he stood behind the backstop. And he was watching the game for a few minutes before he finally decided to ask this little young fellow over here next to the backstop, close to the dugout. He said, "What's the score?" he said to him. He said, "Well, it's 18-0 for them." Well, the guy looked at the little fella and he said to him, "Well, you must be discouraged." And he looked back at the gentleman and he said, "No, discouraged? We're not discouraged. We haven't come up to bat yet." If I could say something to you, Christians, Church of Jesus Christ, pick up your bats, get into the game, all right? The world might want to give you a trouncing, but it's time for you to come to the plate. It's time to be the church that he wants you to be, and you can't be that only in the past. Dream with me, will you? And look at the future that's in front of you. God has some great things in store for all of you. So assess your present situation. No, none of us have arrived yet. Forget all that's behind, both your failures and your successes, and press on toward the prize which is in Christ Jesus. It's little wonder that Paul, when he finished up his life, and he had a chance now to come to the point where, you know, isn't it wonderful when you get older, you can kind of look back, and kind of put things into perspective. So he's writing to young Timothy, one of his proteges, a young pastor. And he puts it all in perspective with a few words. Okay, listen to what he says. "Now, with everything he had to, as I said to you earlier, face and endure, with all the trials he went through, he comes up with these words to Timothy, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. He says, "I fought the good fight. I have finished the race, and I've kept the faith." Isn't that wonderful? What do you want to have over your grave? What epitaph do you want to have written over your tombstone? That's a wonderful thing for all of us if we could put that over all of our tombstones and say, "We fought a good fight. We finished the race, and we kept the faith." And then he goes on to say something, which is really interesting. The Apostle Paul says something right after that verse, and I want to quote it to you today because I think it's important that you hear it. So he says, "Henceforth," he says, "there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me, and not to me only, but to all those who love his appearing." Do you want to love his appearing today? Someday he's coming back. And what the thing I want to hear more than anything else is, "Well done, the good and faithful servant." So let me usher you in to a song as I close. And after the song, David, come on up and start with communion. But I want you to hear this song and think about your life. Put it into context about the next 35 years and what you want to do for the Lord. Because someday, I don't know about you, but me now I'm speaking about, I want to hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord," right? Don't you want to hear that? Mm-hmm. I do. And it comes from living a life of pursuing him at all costs. So there's a video here that I want you to listen to, and it's got some volume with it, Nathan, so hopefully you can pull it up if you need to, some of the volume. The song by the Afters entitled "Well Done."
My pain is gone, and all the worries are swirling. Welcome to